City of Montpelier Development Review Board meeting for this Monday, May 7th, 2018. We're starting a little bit late this evening because of scheduling difficulties with the prior board hearing. However, I'm calling the meeting to order now. My name is Dan Richardson. I am the vice chair and acting chair this evening. And the other members of the DRB from my right are
Jack Lindley,
James Lamonda,
Sarah McShane, staff,
Roger Kranz,
Kate McCarthy.
Okay, and the five members that you see here are the five voting members for this evening. The first order of business is the approval of the agenda.
So moved.
Motion.
Second.
Motion by Jack, second by James. Any further discussion? None. All those in favor, please raise your right hand. Have an agenda. No comments from the chair this evening, other than to note, my understanding is that the sole application before us, which is the Capitol Plaza project, has now fully passed out of the DRC.
That's correct.
And that we have the full application before us for the first time in this project's history. Is that correct?
I'm not sure what you mean by that last comment.
I just mean that we have, there's nothing further that we'll be waiting on.
Yes.
We can complete our review tonight.
That's correct.
If we have the proper evidence and that we're ready to, there's nothing further outstanding.
That's correct.
Okay. Simply all I meant. The approval of the minutes from April 16th.
Okay.
Those present were myself, Jack, Roger, and Kate, so we have a quorum.
Move they be accepted as printed.
Motion by Jack.
Second.
Second by Kate. All those in favor, please raise your right hand that are eligible to vote, and the minutes are approved. All right. So, first order of business is 100 State Street. You were sworn in last meeting, is that correct?
I was, yeah.
Okay. Well,
we can swear. I don't.
Why don't we do this all over again, and then I'll have you introduce yourselves. Anyone who thinks they may be testifying this evening, please raise your right hand. Do you solemnly swear or affirm that the testimony they're about to give for the matter under consideration shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth under the pains and penalties of perjury?
I will.
Okay. So, if you'll just introduce yourself for the record, and I think probably the best way to start is to have you give us a recap of what's new.
Okay, thank you. My name's Greg Rabideau from Rabideau Architects. I'm joined here at the table with Fred Bashar of the Capitol Plaza Corporation, and in the on-deck circle tonight is James Finley Shiris from Wagner Hodgson, our landscape architect, and Ron Lyon from DuBois & King, our project civil engineer. When we last met with this board, we were mostly through the approval of the project when it came to light that we needed to come back in a matter of retaining walls. So this evening's presentation is all about retaining walls, so far as I know. The conditional use and other aspects of the application were dealt with at the prior hearing. What is new in this evening is in this package that I handed out. Should mirror the same package that you got with your from the staff, but we have identified four retaining walls that needed approval by the Design Advisory Committee. And as you noted earlier, they took action just moments ago, so that has happened. The four retaining walls, there are two on the west end of the site, one attached to the end of the Hampton Inn building, and a second that is sort of enveloping the workyard dumpster area attached to the Capitol Plaza building. And there are two retaining walls shown on the eastern end of the site. One that's been of particular public interest, which is creates the transition from the project site to the Christ Church Episcopal, and a second retaining wall down in this corner, which actually happens to be the tallest of the retaining walls, and that is predicated by the installation of the bike path, which the deck elevation on the bridge kind of sets the geometry for that whole bike path across the Haney lot, through Capitol Plaza property, over the train tracks, and to the Taylor Street project. The retaining walls are illustrated on the next two sheets, which are labeled L101.1 and L101.2. And starting at the top of 101.1, you can see that the retaining wall on the top of the page is the one that relates to the bike path location. We could build the garage without it, but we raised that elevation up to the bike path so that we could create that little pocket park that sits in the back of the garage that we spoke of previously. And this will integrate with a retaining wall being proposed as part of the bike path project. And we have coordinated with Stantec on the geometries of those, and we have also coordinated with Stantec and the city on the proposed material. It's a rock-faced concrete product. Three of the retaining walls are modular, they're systems-built ones. This one on the Haney lot is one of those that's built out of individual units. The other two are the one adjacent to the church, and then there's one adjacent to the work yard that I talked about. The only cast-in-place concrete wall, I was corrected earlier, the only cast-in-place wall is the one attached to the Hampton Inn. Also on that page, L101, you see down at the bottom the elevation looking west from church parking lot. That's been an important part of our dialogue with the church, and I think the important things to point out there is that we've worked on the grading around the entrance to the garage and everything to allow this wall to be 2.5 feet tall at its tallest. And that's a big improvement, I think, over what we were talking about last time. So it's knee height now instead of being more substantial, and I think that's a big improvement. Retaining walls that show on page L101.2 are the one on the west end of the hotel that I mentioned is attached to the hotel building. That's simply there to facilitate the rising grade from Taylor Street up to the front entrance of the hotel, which is super elevated because of the floodplain regs. And then the last one that shows here on the bottom of L101.2 is the retaining wall that sort of wraps around where we're planning on putting the dumpsters, and there's a few parking lots, but it's doing a couple of things for us there. James, you had cut sheets of those materials? Yeah, just pass those out or pass them around.
That steel mountain facade be the same for all the retaining walls?
That's it, except for the cast in place wall to the west of the building.
Just so I understand fully, when you say cast in place, that's just essentially the cement wall will have the facing.
It'll be poured at the same time we pour the building foundation, and it'll have, you know, a smooth concrete face. You'll see the form tie knockouts and we'll rub it down and fill any voids and make sure it's uniform in color, but it's a cast concrete wall.
And Sarah, the DRC approved these retaining walls?
Yeah, Mike can probably give an overview. I didn't attend the DRC meetings prior to this, but...
Hey, Mike?
Yep.
Hey, Mike?
Yes.
Do you have the DRC approval for this?
Yes.
Or? Okay, great.
I know we signed it, so.
While they're going through that, do the board have any questions about these retaining walls?
I do have a question that's mostly out of curiosity. On the east retaining wall that you said will align with the bike path retaining wall?
Yes.
Is the bike path retaining wall going to be here on this upper
yes.
edge of the bike path?
Yes.
Okay,
yeah.
So that'll be kind of create.
Yeah.
Okay.
Those plans as well as plans for any improvement on the church property will be subject to separate applications,
right,
logically.
Right.
so.
But those have been sort of, there's been discussion about making them look the same, I think is what you said.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Call that to match the other elevations.
Great. Thanks.
And with the exception of the dumpster retaining wall, all of the other retaining walls sit sort of at the edge of the property facing out.
They do, yeah. The bike path retaining wall would face the Haney parking lot. The only visible portion of the retaining wall adjacent to the church would be visible from the church parking lot side of things. You'll see James has planted a series of shrubs along the top of that so that there's no need for a handrail or...
Keep people from hanging out at the edge of it.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think the big improvement in this plan since we saw you last was the manipulation of those grades to get that grade exchange down to the minimum, the 2.5 feet.
Great. And sorry, Mike, go ahead. Did you have the DRC approval? Was
it
conditioned in any way? Or?
It was not conditioned. In any way. The only notes were that there were no additional utilities proposed in this. I think just the general comments were just the reflection, you know, there was a reflection of the fact that the Tom McArdle had asked that the materials match the bike path, and the applicant had proposed to do that, in particular along the Heaney lot. And then there was some discussion about the poured in place. That was probably one that was talked about more, just to make sure that had the appropriate finish on it, due to its location and the fact that it's the only one that's not matching the block that was proposed in the application.
Although, I mean, its location there at the back of the hotel puts it in a slightly different visual field than. It's not as if it's going to be next to.
I mean, you'll see it as you drive in from Taylor Street.
Oh, no, this is the point. I mean, you'll see it. You'll see. Okay, so I guess my point was, and I'll turn this into a question. Does it sit adjacent to any of the other retaining walls?
No. They wouldn't be a side by side comparison if that's what you're leading up to.
Right, that's where I'm headed with that. Because I think that might be more of a concern, at least in the visual.
No, it'll be tied into the building, and we'll make it look as such. You know, for us, it's a prominent entry corridor into the hotel, so we're going to want that to look pretty nice. And this application doesn't have anything to say about signs, but that might not be a bad place for a sign.
Sure.
Depending on how your regs read. As to the utility comment, I do want to note, just to put some people at ease, we weren't proposing any additional lighting or anything as part of this, but as prior testimony we've talked about, we have made provision for utility connections for the future project next door in our utility planning. That's not a change or anything. I just want to make sure that everybody understands that.
Right. I understood the DRC just simply to say that as their specific sort of sphere of review, that they weren't adding any additional utilities in this very limited review of the retaining walls.
I think we all understand each other. I just know that there are representatives of the church here, and I just wanted to set them at ease. So
given that that's probably the primary thing we're going to be talking about, was there anyone in the audience that wished to comment on the retaining walls or any of the issues associated with them? If you can come up to the microphone and just introduce yourself.
Thank you. My name is Nate Stearns. I'm an attorney representing the church, and just want to say that we appreciate how much Capitol Plaza has worked with us over the course of the last month to address all the church's concerns. And the plans that you can see in front of you tonight have on them essentially what we've worked out with Capitol Plaza to address the impacts on the church property. Capitol Plaza has been great about representing to us that they want to make sure that there's no impacts to the status quo on the church property, and in light of that, and the plans that are here, the church has no objection. We'd like to see the project go forward.
Thank you, Nate. Any other comments? Okay. Oh, sorry, was, okay. Any other comments from the board? I mean, I don't want to go too slowly or too fast through this. There were a couple questions that Tom McArdle raised in email.
Yes.
Have you gotten that opportunity to review that?
He had a long list of comments that I think the only one germane to the night's hearing was that he wanted us to coordinate the material choices between ourselves and the bike path project. It's been my understanding as we go along that the details of the utility connections that Tom mentions in his memo were not a prerequisite for board approval. I think it's our understanding that Public Works will have another bite at this apple when we get to 100% CDs. And so, like his comment about the final detailing of the connection at the of the water line at the street is probably a conversation that will, you know, continue as we go through construction documentation.
Right. And, well, I mean, one of his points is that the design now indicates retaining wall will be constructed above both the existing and proposed mains. We require additional design considerations. Our staff will provide a sketch of the desired interconnection alignment of a stub for future extension. So, I mean, that I understand that that's not really in our purview, but yeah. I just wanted to make you aware of that. Obviously, going forward,
right,
that's something you're going to have to interact with the Department of Public Works for that. But the one above that about the drainage, that was certainly a concern.
I'm gonna invite my civil engineer up to try to put you at ease on that a little bit, because he's had a more or less running dialogue with Tom on this stuff.
Yes, we had talked to Tom a couple times and walked through some of the details, especially the coordination of the retaining walls and the drainage and the water mains. And, I think that most of Tom's comments, all of Tom's comments, tend to be related to the moving forward on detailed design, and the project must be coordinated with the retaining wall with Stantec, for example. I think there was a question on, as we go forward, if the bike path, shared use path goes before the hotel goes, there may be some requirements to coordinate on how do you support that bike path with some kind of a temporary wall, a temporary fill situation, to be sure a bike path could go forward as opposed to being held up by the hotel project. And so that was just something of his concern. He says that's the type of thing. He says we've got Taylor Street going forward, we've got the Transit Center going forward, we've got the bike path going forward, and the hotel going forward all in this small area. And it's, you know, the comment really was just that this is an area's neutral benefit to be sure they all fit together. So we talked about drainage quite a bit. He was pleased with what we've done with drainage for the church, back area of the church. There may be some minor adjustments to that as we go into detailed design and review it with the city. And there may be some adjustments to the water main, because they don't really understand quite where that water main is going on the church property yet. So that's, quite honestly, very normal at this stage. Things will shift a few feet here and there with the water main and work with DPW. So there's nothing, I don't think there's any real serious concerns about working with the city DPW on that. I think the other things that he mentioned was, came up in the last conversation, was Green Mountain Power utility pole at Taylor Street, and looking at the solution on that, which they were looking at some kind of a push pole, but I don't think that's something that's been totally resolved as such, but it's something that will be coordinated with DPW and Green Mountain Power.
That's a Green Mountain Power project, by the way. It's predicated by the Taylor Street project, and it isn't really an integral part of the hotel application other than it happens to sit on the hotel property. No. So it's...
No, I understand that. I think, you know, at least my specific question really came from his first point about the drainage, that there's the three additional lawn drains that are on the church property.
Yes.
And invited DRB scrutiny, and I think that's proper for, you know, how that was being managed as far as future maintenance, ownership, I presume that that will remain church property. Is there going to be an easement or some type of relationship as to future as far as that drainage system? Who will maintain it?
I think there's that is important to have an agreement because it's going to be on church property. We talked to Paul Boyser from Engineering Ventures and on the placement and the number of these and how it would work best for the church property and the memorial garden. We did talk about just, yes, it's something if you're putting utility, anything on someone else's property, it would be something to work out. Much to the same as on the water main extension through the church property and through the Capitol Plaza property. And so that was kind of limited, the discussion was limited to say, yes, we understand that that's a requirement. It's in the memorandum of the church to have that. And it has to be a memorandum to have a discharge point.
So that's why I wanted to make sure that there, so it sounds as if there's a conversation going on with the church that's going to, as part of maybe a larger memorandum with maybe Mr. Stearns. And,
we have a lot of shared interactions to get these two projects built. And so, yeah, there is a memorandum of understanding that's being formed between the parties. The extension of the water line through our property and then across church property is a public works project to replace an aging loop. So this water line that crosses church property is there to charge or provide a backup charge to the water lines on Main Street. And so it's not really a specific benefit to this project. It is part of our global coordination of utilities through this corridor. And those yard drains were there principally to just keep water from ponding on the memorial garden, which, you know, is a delicate area and needs to be preserved. So I guess our expectation is that those facilities that are constructed on the church property will belong to the church. If there's a need for cross easements to connect to the mains, then we can make that happen.
And those were cited based on the survey that the church did, the topographical survey to show that we can get the drainage in that area. I think the church or their engineer is very comfortable that these drains will provide that drainage.
Well, part of our job is not to sort out the easement relationship.
We're not asking you to.
Yeah. No, I understand that, but just to make clear for everyone that I think it's our understanding. We just wanted to raise it. I wanted to raise it simply so that, and I think the testimony that you gave is sufficient, which is that you've started to talk with the church. There's a memorandum of understanding that's being formed and coming together for these rights. And I think that's what Tom McArdle's main point is that, you know, if part of your drainage system lies on another property, you're going to need, you know, rights to maintain that, those drainage systems, both in the installation and then going forward. So it sounds like this is part of a larger universal agreement that you're coming together where
that's correct.
You're letting water mains go through your property for them. They're letting certain easements. I mean, it sounds as part of this larger construction, who knows, and that if that won't shift a little bit over time either.
The community-based utilities are definitely something we'll have to work out with all parties involved. You know, the utility extensions we're talking about on a church property are for the benefit of the church. That should be understood, the yard drains and the parking lot drainage, those were, and a water line extension, those were things done on behalf of the church to make their side of this work. I
hope that the chair, Phil Salinger, has arrived to be added to the role, but you're going to let me?
No, please keep
okay. So I think at this point, is there any questions from the board? Yes,
I have a general question, not related to the walls, but that I think it comes up now because we're talking about the sort of the big plan, the universal coordination, and I have a question about how that works. The first thing I'll say is that it's really clear that everyone's working very hard to communicate with adjacent parties, with other projects, with the city, and that's just always really excellent to hear. So thank you. I know that will continue. I'm still very curious, though, and perhaps also for our listeners at home, to know who is the one who's air traffic control on this? Who is the one person that says, okay, you get to start digging today, you need to wait until tomorrow to dig, fill happens this way, retaining wall goes in now. Is there someone who's the puppet master here? Or is it who, maybe that's not the right term.
Well,
air traffic
control.
You're talking,
are you expanding your scope to consider Taylor Street as well?
I'm thinking of the numerous projects that are taking place, and I wonder, again, just for the interest of the public, is it whoever gets their permit first can start digging and everyone else coordinates accordingly, or?
Well,
I don't think it's
quite going to work like that. One thing we did in assembling our team, or which Capitol Plaza did in assembling our team, was to make sure that there was some continuity between the team members.
Mm-hmm.
So we have the same landscape architect and the same civil engineer for our project as well as Taylor Street. That was a big consideration in our determination of who to pick. Right now, you know, we've been talking to the same general contractor to do both projects.
Mm-hmm.
Hopefully that will continue in that direction. I don't think there's one person who can claim to be king of the hill. I think the same level of coordination that's gone between ourselves and the church to get to this point with them,
mm-hmm,
will happen to a lesser degree with Taylor Street, which is adjacent but not abutting, and the bike path project, which I think has the potential to be a real coordination issue.
So it's mostly between the private parties is what I'm hearing you say, as opposed to someone standing on top of the hill saying, go, go, go.
As project architect, I'll coordinate the efforts of our team, and we've had direct and very constructive dialogue with the architects from Taylor Street and from Stan Tech, who's handling the bike path part of it.
I also had the to address the city's part of this. Tom McArdle said we're going to have very close coordination with the city project manager for the city. Corey Lyon has been assigned to look at all those pieces, and he's already doing that now on several projects in that area.
That might have been the point person answer that I was anticipating.
It's kind of nice, because it really is. You've got that go-to person to say, our project and their project are coming together in these pieces at this time.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm pretty comfortable with that.
Okay. Like I said, I've heard that the coordination between parties is very good, very positive, the way you've explained it, Greg. But I was sort of wondering if there was that one person at the city who was
It's going to be
tough. The big view. Yeah.
There could be some real benefits, though, because certain subcontractors mobilize to the site, and if they're stripping concrete forms off of one project and moving next door with them, yeah, I think that's the hope on the contracting team side of things.
Yep.
It'll really come down to, for us, we anticipate a November start, if depending on the tax increment financing portion of this. And one of the reasons why we needed to get wrapped up and why we've been pushing to conclude this part of it is we think we're going to need all of that for 4 or 5 months to get this nailed down.
Yeah, cool. Well, thank you for answering that question, particularly since it doesn't pertain to the walls we're looking at, but I think it's an important overall thing for folks to understand.
It's
so
gotta work.
Yeah. Thank you.
Over the last few points, I think there's a few small items of business that we need to address. One is the snow storage. Apparently there was a bit of a typo in some of the earlier ones, putting snow storage in different locations, and I just wanted to confirm my understanding, looking at the drawings now, is the temporary snow storage location is to the west of the Post Hotel.
Yes. It was determined at earlier hearings that we had more parking than is required by your zoning ordinance. Although we want to need all that parking, I think it was determined that we could take some of those out of service so long as we were staying within compliance with your regs. It's the practice now, and it will continue to be the practice, that snow will be removed from the site at the earliest convenience. And they're off-siting it now to the snow depot.
The city does it now. And that would be the plan continuing.
Yep. The city works on this, yes.
And then the other comment that the staff had raised, and this may, I don't know if you've had an opportunity to review some of the staff comments from this, tonight's meeting, was about the loading and siting of parking and loading spaces. And these are under the old zoning bylaws, in particular sections 706 and 707. But it talks about the required, the regulations requiring for buildings containing hotels, one off-street loading space for every 10,000 square feet of gross floor area. And by our calculations, that would be about five. And my understanding is there's really only one off-space loading, and so you haven't necessarily requested a waiver, but one might be implied from this.
If it's not too late, I would ask you to consider that. I think a loading space for every 10,000 square feet of hotel is probably excessive in my view, because this is not a full service hotel in the sense that it doesn't have a restaurant, or which would be a big generator of waste, any significant other spaces that would require a lot of delivery of materials. Right now, what happens is trucks come in behind the parking lot, and they park essentially adjacent to where we're showing our trash and recycling, and they just unload there. We've made sure that they can pull in and turn and get back out, but we just don't have the real estate to create a huge loading dock area, and it seems to be working now. I mean, the real heavy traffic is servicing a restaurant, to be honest, at the banquet facility, the existing hotel. But I don't anticipate a lot of new demand being sprung from this Hampton Inn. So if there were a way to ask for that waiver, I would ask for it.
Board, have any questions? So just so I understand, your expectation is that the new inn is not going to require the same type of loading as say the Capitol Plaza. But you know, what type of weekly loads are you anticipating? I mean, you're expecting, I mean, obviously there are some food and beverages that are going
to
be sold.
You have to provide a minimum self-service breakfast.
Right.
Which is cereals, and you pour your own waffles and juice. That's about it. And it's standardized throughout the whole, we're
right.
Told by Hampton exactly what we have to have, where it's supposed to be, who does it, and everything else. So.
But I mean, that is that delivered then on a weekly basis?
Depending on usage. If it's not, you store it in your refrigerators and your storage pantries, wherever you need it.
Yeah, I mean, if you have the architectural drawings that were submitted with the application, you can see that the amount of food preparation area in here is a room that's about 11 feet wide and about 14 feet long. Most of you probably have bigger kitchens in your homes. And you're going to have hot eggs, bagels, fresh fruit, yogurts, that kind of stuff. Generally, I mean, we've worked with a lot of hoteliers. Generally, that kind of stuff is getting picked up at Costco. You're not going to see the big Shadow Cross Farms or the Provenders, Black River Produce, or any of those. They're coming to the site. They're going next door to the Capitol Plaza. Yeah, other than that, I mean, the big event for loading here will be when the furniture shows up, and that'll be part of construction operations. Obviously not a permanent situation.
And then, like, cleaning supplies and the normal other items that go into the running of the hotel, that's not a... I'm just trying to understand.
It's not a tractor trailer.
It's not a tractor trailer.
It's a small box truck. We get at the theaters, we get at all our locations. They drop it off and run in.
Would the plan for that box truck be to park in that loading zone, or would it be to park in front of the entrance?
So small, they can park anywhere, really.
Right. Well, I'm just so I understand, you know, because part of what we have to do, and I think the board, I haven't heard any statement to the contrary, that we're willing to entertain the idea of waiver, but I think it's helpful for us to understand what we're waiving. And so if there's a box truck coming with these supplies, you know, would it be reasonable for us to say that they would park under the awning in the entrance to unload these type of materials, or would there be another location that that?
We probably, I mean, just as a sort of social thing, wouldn't want them going through the lobby with that stuff. Generally speaking, we kind of want them to go to the east end door, or the west end door, and come in that way, because that's where the food prep and food storage stuff is, and a lot of the employee-based storage type areas. Laundry for this hotel will be done next door at the Capitol Plaza, so there'll be some cart traffic going back and forth. But yeah, I mean, when we came up with that little work yard, I mean, that was intended to sort of do a lot of things, you know, get a lot of the stuff, the dumpsters and the bread racks and stuff out of sight and in a controlled, contained area.
Yes, I was going to just confirm, you said all the there won't be any laundry deliveries. The laundry is all going to be done on elsewhere on the site.
It's going to be done in the Capitol Plaza.
Linens and towels.
Yes.
So that wouldn't be a loading or unloading facility.
No, that's going to be a houseman with a cart going back and forth between the two buildings, I think. Or, you know.
Tough road in January.
Well, it is.
I thought about a tunnel under.
Another variance.
Yeah. it makes sense to have that equipment busy all the time and to not have two sets of it if I can afford it.
Any other questions from the board? Okay. So I think, just reviewing the packet, I think we've covered all the additional items, understanding that this is end of a very long process. Do any of the board members have any either overarching questions or issues that have previously received testimony on you wish to elicit further?
Two questions.
Yes.
Greg, I was wondering if you could provide just a brief overview. So the plans were, I reviewed the plans last week prior to Thursday, and I was just wondering if you could provide a brief overview of the revisions made to the plans that were submitted on Thursday. And then just for clarification, what improvements are you guys seeking approval for that are off-site?
Okay. I think there were some spot elevations and a few minor changes to the retaining walls adjacent to the church that came up. Monday, we got staff comments from Tom, and so we took some of Tom's thinking into account as well. The changes between Monday and Thursday were not substantial, but it was really just, I think at one point, if you look at the planting bed around the, there's this sort of planting bed, that at one point had a wall that was 2 feet high all around. We've let that just turn into a curb now. As far as off-site improvements go, I don't know that the board can approve off-site improvements. It's our understanding that what will have to happen ultimately is that Christ Church Episcopal will come in with an application for some of these little detail-y things on their property, there may be things that Capitol Plaza is donating or constructing for them, but our understanding is that they need to have a separate permit for improvements on their land. We've illustrated this in a way that shows you it all comes together, but I think the permit for us will stop at the property line. That said, there are some site utilities that are definitely part of this project that do go off-site, the most notable of which is our storm drainage facility, which will more or less parallel the bike path and discharge to the north branch of the Winooski River through the headwall of the bike path bridge. So that's an off-site utility that's illustrated in the civil engineering plans that we would want approved, and expect that Public Works has reviewed that and understand it and think it's okay. And then, of course, you know, we'll have some utility improvements in State Street, which will be part of the project, not strictly on our property.
I think most of the drainage under the bike path is part of the bike path project by the city already. So I believe that's all approved. as far as I'm.
You know, the city does own that bike path area, we don't.
Right. I think Sarah's question, this would be,
No, I just want to make sure I fully understand what the permit covers.
That's my understanding of the law, that's been our position right along. We've gone beyond that and illustrated what we think is a workable solution for the church so that we can put the church at ease and we can put you at ease that when they come in with their application, these two things can't work together. So we've essentially provided them a curb cut and a curb stop for water and a plug-in for stormwater at the property boundary. There will be improvements on church land, and whether it's us or Engineering Ventures or somebody who comes forward and completes that for them, they still have some thinking about how they really want this to be finished on their end. And we don't want to get in the way of that process. You know, they have another project coming and they're thinking about that at the same time. But we've done this in a way that it's shown that it works and the impacts on the church are better. And if we have to help them get over that, we will. But I don't see a way for you to approve these improvements on another piece, on a private property owner's land, without them making an application.
Well, I just want to understand, are there any of these, I understand the improvements that, why you're trying to show that the Episcopal Church will be able to do what they can do. And obviously that's been an important part of your negotiations with them. I think part of what Sarah's question is going towards, and I'd like to know, are there any improvements apart from utilities, such as power lines or issues, that are you're relying upon for the way in which your project's going to function that may be located off-site? You know, we were talking earlier about these storm drains. It's different if the storm drains are part of how the church is going to develop its property and ensure that it meets its obligations. It's different if these storm drains have been installed or being sought so you can meet your storm drain obligations.
They're not. No, let me make that emphatically clear. The issue is that we have a stormwater regulation that says your first floor has to be at 527. As we build up this fill section to meet that requirement, we're sort of essentially damming off the southwest corner of the church's property so that their existing parking and their memorial garden, there's an expressed concern that water could impound there, and so we're providing a method for it to get off of their property. But the stormwater is generated on church property, and the facilities are there to deal with that. There are improvements that we will provide as part of our agreement with them or whatever, but I could take that retaining wall and run it straight from State Street back to the garage and not impact the church at all with a driveway or anything. It's just that we've had this agreement, this working arrangement, to maintain access to the church in the way that we've illustrated. So does that make it any better for you?
It does, and it's in part what you're describing is because you're altering the way in which water either flows or comes off of land. I think this is an issue that sounds like something that you're arranging, working out with the church to avoid any private contacts that they might have as to changing the way water flows between these two problems.
Yes. But ultimately, once that's all done and those utility improvements are made, they'll be church property and the church will maintain them as they maintain the rest of their property.
Okay. Yeah.
Yes.
Would it be fair to say that whatever changes may be made to the church's property aren't necessarily improvements as much as they are reactions to mitigate the impact of what your development is going to do on your property?
I think that's a fair characterization, yeah.
That's number one. Number two, do you have a license from the church to enter onto its property to take these mitigating steps?
It's not fully consummated, but we are working towards that goal. And I expect a part of that will be that they'll come in with an application under their authorship, signed by them, saying, we're making these improvements on church property. if it's in some part in reaction to us, so be it, but there'll be another step in this process for them, I think.
The actual response to my question about whether there's a license is, really, if they want the mitigating steps to be taken, they should give you permission to enter.
Yeah, and I, you know, maybe Nate can speak to that, but I mean, we're coordinating on,
right.
Last time I looked at the list, there was probably 20 bullet points, so.
Any further questions from the board?
Sir, do you have anything?
Mm-hmm. How does the board wish to proceed?
Mr. Chair, I'll recommend that we close the hearing and that we go into deliberative session for this particular file.
Okay. Motion by Jack.
Second.
Second by Roger. Any further discussion? Anything further?
Would deliberative session be after this session, or are you going to do
yes.
it at a date for in the future?
No, we'll do it. We'll probably start after this session, and then okay. usually what happens when we do a deliberative session is we end up issuing a written permit that, and especially given the scope and size of this project, is going to have a number of different findings written out.
Yeah, the only other thing I wanted to mention is I wanted to thank Sarah McShane for sticking in past her employment date to help us get through this. We've enjoyed our working relationship with city staff. I think it's been really good, and just wanted to make note of that because Sarah has moved on to Stowe. But I thank you all for your time and your patience.
Thank you.
Okay. Thanks to other participants as well.
Hearing no further discussion, all those in favor of taking the closing action going into the deliberative session, please raise your right hand. And we're going to move into deliberative session. We've closed the record. Thank you very much.
Thank you all for your time.
Yes, appreciate it. Let's just take care of the other business and then we'll take the session. Okay, sorry everyone, just if you can be a little quiet, we have to finish our nominal amount of business before we move into deliberative session. This is a note, other business, looks as if the 4 Spring Street has been withdrawn by the applicant. And then the 213 Main Street sketch plan was tabled by the applicant.
Yeah,
to
but
make
a motion table? To continue it.
Okay. So 213 Main Street has asked to be tabled to our May 21st meeting.
I'm going to make a motion to table the 213 Main Street application until May 21st.
Friendly amendment, you mean continue?
Yeah, continue.
Motion by Roger. Do I have a second?
I'll second.
Second by James. All those in favor, please raise your right hand. And it is continued. Our next regularly scheduled meeting is for Monday, May 21st, 2018. And James, is this your last meeting?
With the hotel look like it's being done, yes. I think this will be the last application I'm going to be a part of.
Well, personally, and I'm sure the board as well, thank you very much for the years of service. And,
I'm sure I'll see everybody around. I'm just doing different things.
Exactly.
How many years of service do we give you credit for, James?
Oh, I don't keep that close to track. 6 or 7, something like that.
Bigger than a bread box.
Yeah, we've been in Montpelier 9, so it's been most of that.
Great. Thank you.
So I'll
If I could just make one comment about our chairman. He deserves an incredible thank you for the people of Montpelier for shepherding what I consider to be a massive revitalization of downtown. And without Phil in the chair and being here, we could have never gotten it done. And I just applaud his efforts, and I think the people of Montpelier, when you see them on the street, thank you.
We'll take they just try to run me over.
We'll take a motion to adjourn and move into deliberative session.
So moved.
A motion by James. So
second.
Second by Jack. All those in favor of adjourning and moving into deliberative session, please raise your right hand. We are adjourned.